before the audience?
I think the guidance to the police departments because of the case law is that if you're going to do a custodial interrogation and there's an ability to report it, you should report it. It's going to give the person an opportunity to decide whether they want it reported or not, and oftentimes people don't want it reported.
It would save a lot of time and issues like motions to suppress.
Yes.
Not in the hearing.
It does. Well, I'm provided with videos to take a look at myself.
Would it matter to you in a case on appeal that the issue on a reported criminal case was not recorded? If you take that into consideration, if it was briefed to you?
Yes. It would be important.
Did you ever find a lawyer for being late?
No.
Did you ever locked up a lawyer for being late?
No.
Did you ever locked a lawyer up for any reason?
No.
The one. Do you know if judges have done it?
I just heard rumors. I don't know that that's the case.
But that would not be you doing something. Do you believe in outstrip, please?
Yes.
Yeah, have you done them?
I've accepted them. There's a reason for them.
Do you believe in time standards?
Again, you know, there's standards. There's a reason for them. I understand that. But not all cases are able to stay within time standards for practical reasons. So in my own, as a First Justice, I do have to monitor my cases. And we always have a list that's out of time standards, and many times it's because of many times the mental health cases where the report's not being done in a timely fashion because of issues with not having enough clinicians.
You believe that people should be assessed a $65 a month probation fee, supervision fee if they're not being supervised?
I believe they should be supervised.
No, but if they're not being supervised.
Supervision fee, so it should go ahead and hang out with probation supervision.
You think people are being supervised on probation?
Michael, yes.
What about other courts?
I can't speak to what's going on in other courts, but if it's my court, I'm supposed to. That's my understanding. If they're paying a supervised probation fee, they should be supervised.
My experience is that most people pay $65 a month supervision if they show up once or twice, even to a customer.
My understanding from speaking with the chief of my probation department as well as the officers, they make home visits. They're very involved on supervision cases. And of late, the probation department has started to establish more rules, and they're becoming more standardized as what does supervision mean and what are the requirements for the hearing officers. So all of that has been improving. Yes.
Thank you very much, Chief. I just have a few questions. You applied to this job in 2016?
Yes, I did.
And you know what month? Like the beginning of the year, the end of the year?
I can't remember. I think it might have been the
end of the year. And before that, you were on the district court for approximately 10 years. I think I voted for you way back then. Have you applied to any other courts?
There were some prior openings in the appeals court, and at that point, my application wrote appeals court / superior court, but my interest was truly appeals court.
Okay, so and when did you First of all, when did you apply for this one?
Sorry, for this one?
Yes. Okay, take some time.
I have here November 2015.
2015. And other than the district court?
Yes.
Have you applied? I was a little confused when you said slash appeals court slash, I'm sorry.
It was a single application. I think on the application, they ask you what positions are you applying for. There were openings on both the appeals court and superior court. My preference was to go to the appeals court because there were always also superior court positions. I got the advice that I should seek both. I did that.
So if you got selected, if you didn't get selected for the appeals court, you would have accepted an appointment to the superior court.
At that point, when I put my application, this application is strictly for the appeals court.
Okay, so I'm sorry. So prior to this application, which was strictly the appeals court, prior to this, you applied to appeals court slash superior court.
That's right.
And what was the status of that application? Was that in front of me?
That was under
Patrick.
I went to the JNC. I went to the joint bar, where I understand I was approved there. I met with the chief legal counsel.
Kate Cook at the time, or Marilyn O'Connell, the assistant? Or?
I'm sorry, it was a man. They called him.
Hold on, excuse me.
I'm sorry, I don't recall the name, but it was a man. I simply wasn't put forward as the candidate.
Okay. So you had an interview with the government's legal counsel.
Yes.
That's as far as it went.
Well, even after that interview, my name was sent to the joint bar. In that administration, I think the process had been that once your name goes to the joint bar, it comes up a thumbs up, you're the candidate. But that didn't happen.
I'm a little confused now. I want to see if I have this right. Generally speaking, you go to the JNC, in this case, it's 2015 or prior, that appeals court slash superior court. You got through the JNC, you met with the legal counsel for
That's right.
Governor Patrick.
That's right.
And then after that, your name went to the joint bar.
Yes.
And it was your understanding that if you got thumbs up from the joint bar, that was a good sign, and then more likely than not, that you'd get appointed by Governor Patrick.
And the only reason I have that understanding is that's how it happened for me before, but that was 10 years ago. So that process may have changed.
What gets me is that's my understanding. So I guess my question is, that's my understanding, the way it is and the way it was under Governor Patrick. But to me, from the way you're describing it, I'm saying to myself, you must have had an issue with the joint bar, because I think there's other people here who were on the council when Governor Patrick was, and that was the procedure. But you're making it seem you didn't have an issue with the joint bar. Or you don't know.
I don't know, but it was related to me that I got the thumbs up.
Okay, but...
And just wait for a call.
Okay. But you never got an official, you've been okay from the joint bar.
I didn't get anything in writing, but I never did 10 years ago either.
I understand. My understanding is, and it's happened, I don't want to say frequently, but maybe one out of 25, one out of 35, that a name will go in front of the joint bar, and if it thumbs down, then the governor will not appoint you. But I don't know the certainty. Let me ask this, back to the jury way case. Okay.
Yes.
I want to just get an understanding of that. I thought you said, and I could be wrong, first of all, I don't go to court. I'm a lawyer, but I don't go to court. I used to do criminal law many, many years ago. So the party that can ask for a jury way trial is the defendant's attorney. Is that correct? And I thought you said, and you can correct me, most defense attorneys don't go or don't request to go jury way to fight.
That's true. I've had a few jury waived cases.
So, but you do acknowledge that lawyers do request to go jury waived in front of judges.
Yes.
But you're, for whatever reason, they don't, it's not something that happens a lot with you. My question is, why? Why do you think? Obviously, no one's going to tell you, but what's your gut feeling? They don't want to go in front of you. I'm curious as to why.
I think naturally people would think that people associate me with, I work for both the state prosecutor's office, for the U.S. attorney's office. That's what people's knowledge of my background is. That they would, from that, expect that I'm pro-prosecution, and that in terms of, if I personally had to make a factual determination that it would be in favor of the prosecution. I believe that's probably the...
Has anyone told you, whether a friend of yours, another colleague, hey, a lot of people don't want to go in front of you because of A, B, C. That's just your gut feeling, or has somebody actually told you that?
You hear sort of rumors in the courthouse, well, it's between you and Judge, so-and-so. And so I've heard that, not because of any particular this reason or that reason.
Okay. Now, you were an assistant DA at one point.
Yes.
And that was how many years ago? 15 years ago?
20? Yes.
Yeah, a long time. And then after that, you're a prosecutor at the U.S. Attorney's Office?
Well, I worked at being a large...
No, I understand. But that's...
Oh, it's later I was at the U.S. Attorney's Office. Yes.
And that, and when did you left there, what, 12 years ago? So you've been a district court judge for 10 years. So people in the last 10 years have a chance to observe you, go in front of you. So I could understand that rationale if you've been a judge for a year. But someone's been a judge for 10 years. That's a long time. I'm surprised that they still don't want to go jury waived. And let me just finish. Don't want to go jury waived in front of you. Because you then now have a reputation. Forget what you were before. I mean, I'm not sure that these people even know that you were a prosecutor. So that's a little troubling to me. That people do jury waive cases all the time, but they don't want to go in front of you. You know, I'm just not convinced by the fact that people look at you and say, you're a prosecutor. I don't think if I did a criminal case, unless you do them all the time, a lot of lawyers don't do a ton of criminal cases. I mean, they do a lot, but some people, maybe they do 5, 10, 15 a year. But in your situation, no one's going near you. And that's troubling to me. Does that bother you, that people don't want to go in front of you? Obviously, to me, that means they don't think they're going to get a fair shot. Whether they're right or wrong, would you at least agree with that?
I agree with what?
That these lawyers who don't want to go in front of you, jury waive, which you acknowledge, they obviously take the position they're not going to get a fair shot. Okay, but you said to me that the reason they don't go in front of you, at least what you think through rumors or whatever, is because they perceive you as pro-prosecutor.
I'm trying to think of the thinking process, and I think that that's a natural assumption for someone who's spent half their
career. Okay, so they don't think. They'd rather go in front of someone who's not a prosecutor, using your theory.
Perhaps.
And they think that because they don't think they can get as fair a shot with a prosecutor.
I guess I don't equate that as being fair or not fair.
What do you equate it with?
That there was a factual determination to be made that I might view things in a manner more sympathetic to the prosecution. I guess I still don't.
Okay, let's use that. Let's assume that. So there's a lot of lawyers who don't go in front of you jury waived because they believe they can see things more favorably to the government.
That could be.
And in 10 years, have you tried to convince people otherwise?
I'm not looking for people to go jury waived in front of me. I love our jury system. I prefer that people exercise their right to a jury trial.
Well, with all due respect, that might be your opinion, and I appreciate it. But for some defense lawyer, his or her job is one thing, to make sure his client is found not guilty. Am I right? That's his job, her job. You agree?
Yes.
And I'm just concerned that over the last 10 years, people still, forget the fact that you were prosecuted 15, 20 years ago, people still think, I don't want to go in front of this judge because I think she's going to more favorably than not, more often than not, favor the Commonwealth. That's troubling to me. Again, Judge Sharpen. I'm a big fan of Judge Sharpen. I think any good lawyer is going to judge Sharpen, because you do agree that not every case that you hear and you find or rule on, another judge will not do the same thing. Another judge may do the same thing, but may not do have the same ruling.
Yes.
And after 10 years, you have a reputation that lawyers in the community know or should know what type of judge and certain rulings that you'll give, because it may be gone in front of you several times.
Everybody's got a reputation.
Yeah, so knowing that, don't you think that lawyers aren't doing their job if they don't judge Sean?
I think it would be very important if you had to know who the fact finder is. Yes, I understand why you want to, before you sit down and make that jury waiver determination, I completely understand why you want to know who the fact finder is.
Yeah.
That doesn't bother me.
It doesn't bother you that lawyers go jury waive a lot of cases. When you're in, it was Concord, is that right? Concord District Court, they're staying away from you. They don't want, what was the last case you had with that was jury waived?
Pretty recent, actually. I believe it may have been
And was it 2017? Was it 2016?
Could have been 2016 or 2015.
So it could have been a year and a half, 2 years ago. Doesn't seem, with all due respect, too recent to me.
But generally, since I've been first justice, the way it works is that I sit in first session, and then the second judge comes in for the jury session. And if somebody wants to go jury pick, jury waive, often it's that judge. But if we need to do two trials, I'll do one.
And how many judges are in Concord?
On jury days, it'll typically be two judges. Other days, it'll be awesome.
Okay. The two judges, you know whether or not they have cases. You're the chief judge there, correct?
Yes.
I assume you're going to know this question. Do you know whether or not they have cases before them that a jury would?
Yes, sometimes. Not often.
I'm just curious. I don't want to give you a hard time, but when you say sometimes, what does that mean? Once a week, or two?
Well, OUI cases are the cases that I think are very often tried to jurors. And in my court, anyway. So I don't think it's very often that we have jury waiting trials.
Once a week? Once a month?
Yeah, perhaps. It's more than one of them.
I was under the impression from talking to other defense attorneys that it's more than that. I could be wrong.
But it depends on who's sitting. Maybe a year ago there would have been a different judge that was in that session, and that judge had a different reputation, and perhaps they got more jury waiver trials.
Because that judge would be more friendly to the defendant.
That was the perception, yes.
My last question is, and this is a question I always ask. If one of the counselors votes against you, and either he or she comes before you, or we're all small people here in the sense that it's not like if you work for Hutchin or a big law firm. We don't have no big law firm like that. If either one of the counselors or someone from their firm asks you to recuse yourself, what would you do? Thank you. Just to let you know, this has not happened to me, but another counselor, obviously I won't say the name, I asked that question, and this counselor had a case where the counselor had voted no. The counselor's associate asked the judge to recuse him or her, to recuse herself, and the judge would. But we can get 100% assurances from you, but if that came up, you would recuse yourself?
Certainly.
Okay. Well, that's good. I appreciate your answers. And, I don't have any more questions.
Thank you.
What made you
want to
be an attorney?
Just a general notion of wanting to do some good things in the world, and idea that there was this sort of structured way that you could do that. And then I felt that I had some talents for writing and practicing.
Yeah, you've done a lot of writing. It's actually quite impressive. And I know you answered this before, but I'd like you to elaborate a little bit more on it. Is why the appeals court? Why going from district to appeals? Or not to superior?
First of all, I've been on a trial court for 10 years. Mm-hmm. I love the court that I'm on, the work that I'm doing. I don't think that I, at this point, need experience in another trial court. I don't have. And so, and it, I think from the beginning, I've had an appellate team that's run through my career from the my very first opportunity mm-hmm. to do any sort of legal work at all, from my very first internship. It was appellate work. It's satisfying. It's just purely personally satisfying. And it's also challenging. Mm-hmm. And I like the opportunity to have the time to do it on a full-time basis. We get sort of chunks of time to really think and to craft. I understand that there's a heavy caseload, so you cannot probably do everything that you'd like to do, but it's personally satisfying. And right now in the district court, I do have the opportunity to do it on a limited basis, and there's some of my most satisfying things to look at, so we finish our product at the end of the day.
And do you think you'd enjoy working on a panel?
Yes, although I was surprised when I made the transition from having been a trial court judge, sort of making my own decisions, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden having to collaborate with people, convince people, and it can be a frustrating experience, but I've done that.
But you found it satisfying.
Now, yes. Yeah. And now what I really appreciate is to learn from my colleagues. Mm-hmm. I really, really appreciate sort of being able to really look at someone else's thinking process and learn that.
Well, in Counsel Jubinville said, one of the most important attributes of a judge is listening. And I've said many times, when we listen, we learn. You know, when we go in and we listen to what our colleagues and what others have to say, really listen to it. I love somebody that can change my mind. That's what I love, because I'm stubborn and I stick it and look at you. You know, I've got my thoughts and my opinions and I think I'm right. When I can meet somebody who can intellectually challenge me enough that actually changed my mind, I absolutely love that. Because that means I'm learning. So you did, you started doing a lot of appeals work when you were with District Attorney Tom Riley?
Yes, the District Attorney.
And was that just, did it just sort of turn that way that you just got assigned to some of these?
When I came in, that was I was hired to be in the appeals.
Okay.
And so that was primarily what I did the entire time.
Okay. And then what did you primarily do at Binham? Were they more big?
So it was, they were very big cases.
Yeah. So I mean, that's a huge firm.
Right. So it was a civil litigation. My practice group was white collar defense.
Yeah.
Because I had come in with a lot of sort of trial experience, mm-hmm. even though it was more limited than trial attorneys in the district court, it was more than typically associates would have in a big firm. So I was put on a lot of cases to right away start doing a lot of depth. So I did a lot of depositions, mm-hmm. a lot of discovery, witness preparation, and then motions.
Was that work mostly? Were you ever sitting in court on trials for that? Or were you mostly doing
a lot of it was in the background.
Okay, that's right. So, and then you went to the U.S. Attorney's Office in the Major Crimes Unit. Sounds very interesting.
It was.
what What did you, what would you say were your biggest lessons there that you took away that helped you as a judge and or will help you if you make it to the appeals court?
At the U.S. Attorney's Office?
Yeah, so particularly in the major crimes unit. Because you're dealing with bank robberies, narcotics, thefts, probably, I'm going to guess, white-collar crime, any money laundering, anything like
well,
that?
Well, actually, I was hired to be in the public corruption unit. They put you in major crimes as sort of a training to do regular criminal cases and get you up on your feet in the federal district court. So that was sort of a training that I had, and it wasn't really much different from the state court criminal work you do as a prosecutor.
Mm-hmm.
You had to really learn how they do things on the federal side. But my primary work, I was hired to focus on the issue of human trafficking. There was a sort of an effort all across the country from the Justice Department to start focusing on it, and so I established a task force to deal with it. So we dealt with local law enforcement in conjunction with the federal, most likely the ICE agents. And so I did that, and in the time that I was there, I had a handful of trafficking cases. Some went to trial, a few of them fled after the detention hearing. So I started the question.
I wanted to ask you that very thing. Were they mostly were they international trafficking or in states? Because there's a lot of human trafficking in the United States.
Yes. So even though I was
of American citizens.
That's right.
Is what I'm trying to say.
That's right.
And people don't really. We hear human trafficking, and we're thinking, they're bringing all these folks from other places. if you look at some of the work the Attorney General's doing on this right now, and you can see on the maps the things. Who's paying these sites? It's like all around this radio building, but it's really fascinating, not in a particularly good way, where this stuff is coming from.
So at the U.S. Attorney's Office, it was focused on, my cases happened to be all international mm-hmm. cases, so I had a Chinese investigation going on, and this was sexual servitude, on the other Chinese case. I had a Brazilian and a couple of Brazilian cases. One was labor trafficking, cleaning.
Mm-hmm.
But so they brought over here, and then they're perpetually indebted for having been able to be brought over here. And then there was a Brazilian sex trafficking case as well. I was starting a Russian one.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't really get far with that one before I called up to the district court bench. But it was primarily international trafficking. But as I said, we had put together this task force, and it was primarily the Boston Police Department that we were working with as partners. And they, through working with us, really getting up to speed on the issues, they started their own investigations, the local trafficking cases. And then when I came to the bench, I started to see them come into my court. It was eye-opening.
That was actually a perfect segue, because that was my next question, is how much of this have you seen in the district court and experiences with that?
I saw some of it, but some of it comes in as women being charged
mm-hmm.
with prostitution. And then if the investigators look a little deeper, or the defense attorneys who are assigned to the cases, when they investigate what's going on, then it turns into something else. If everything works as it should, they go to the prosecution, they explain what's going on, and then hopefully the prosecution sees it and takes it in a different direction.
Yeah, and I'd be interested, I'll have to reach out to Salva and see if they're doing any particular work on this, because with the changes on a national level right now, and the, we all know ICE is showing up at courthouses. And stuff, and a lot of people, it's almost driving folks like this underground in a very unsafe way, and it's a real fine line to walk. I think for us who are electeds and who are sitting on benches, I will say that I am very, very concerned because of our climate right now in DC, that the state courts and particularly the appeals court we're really in this period. Paying very close attention to what's going on in these courts. We've got a great team right now, and we want to keep it great. other tasks will be more important than they've ever been. Because you're our first line of defense for Massachusetts citizens. One of the issues that I am very concerned about, and it also dovetails into this, is, and I'd like to know if you have any experience dealing with this community in court, or maybe, I don't know, when you're lawyering before you went to the court, if you would have, but our gay, lesbian, transgender community, especially the youth, they are at high risk for prostitution and being trafficked. They're extremely vulnerable. I've said many times in this chamber, when these kids feel safe on the street, then they feel at home. We're in a foster home, we're doing something very, very wrong. It is a tough issue for a lot of people to get their heads around and everything, but it's a real issue. And have you had experience in these folks coming into your courtroom, particularly for sex crimes or anything else?
I've seen, we have had in our court young transgender people who are in there for certain crimes, the defense attorney of an accident in my court, and they brought to my attention these other things that are going on with them, and are just so dedicated that they've gone out and bought the services, and the cases have been resolved in a criminal fashion.
But which is, it's always to mediate and everything is always a great goal. I mean, we want to do that type of thing. But the awareness that what I'm asking of you, whether you go to the appeals court or stay on this court, is that you really, if you haven't, or if you have continued to educate yourself about these issues in this community, because it is a very, very vulnerable community. The statistics on particularly on the youth attempting suicide, STDs, pregnancy by young lesbians who are working as sex workers because it's the only work they can get. It's an epidemic. And, again, I say we're not Russia, we're the United States. We can do better than that. It's not up to us to judge whether we agree with this or not. This is a very real thing.
And thank you for pointing out that issue. We do have these educational series at our courthouse, and we've been focusing a lot on the opioid epidemic and those kinds of issues. This would be definitely for another session.
So,
and I'm sorry, I had some people leave. My children have to be picked up from preschool. So.
That's all right. It's good to have support. I know you've said that you don't want to do anything to supplement your judicial salary, and I don't know if you're teaching now, you get supplemental.
At this point, if my family
with their little kids, you can't do it.
Doing teaching.
Yeah. I was going to say, it would be great to see you do some teaching at some point. But I do understand when you have little ones.
No, I've done teaching in the past.
Yeah, I know you have.
I wouldn't pick it up for a while.
Yeah, because you really have a lot to offer, particularly with the writing. And I think one of your clerks talked about how having you as a teacher was probably influenced on her. So another community that I'm very concerned about are people who are perhaps mentally disabled, somewhere on the autism spectrum,
yes.
Perhaps somebody with MR, that type of. Now, I tell people, I had a sister with Down syndrome. My sister ended up in a courtroom, you could look at her and you would know she had a disability. And so you may adjust your language or your sentence or whatever, the path to her because of that. But when we have folks who are maybe someplace on the spectrum, we may not know that. And even their attorneys, even if it's a CPCS attorney, or even if they're there as a pro se, really might not know that. They may not. Have you experienced that in your court at all, working with this special community?
Certainly we have. And so we have, unfortunately we don't have
on site. And that's one of, that's a principal problem that is certainly.
That's interesting.
That's a, is that something you would think we maybe should do?
Well, it would be excellent to have on-site clinician. Because sometimes you see something and you really need an expert opinion of where you go from here, and that decision has to be delayed. Right? Mm-hmm. Some decision needs to be made, and you're in a real tough spot as to what to do when you don't exactly know what the issue is.
Yeah. And those can be, and the reason I bring it up is because those are a lot of times social issues that are the way folks interact with people. It doesn't absolve them of a crime. You know, people know what's right and what's wrong. It doesn't mean you're innocent because of something, but it may mean that you, as a judge, adjust how you handle the case or handle the person for their own protection and safety.
Yes, yes. And Detective Lieutenant Jones here was instrumental in getting this, all the towns in our court together under this grant to really deal with this issue. Again, it's a diversion program.
Yeah.
And so part of it is we have some excellent people there who are great communicators and educators, and they're putting on a series of programs, not only for the people in the court system, which is primarily we need to have, but also for the community, so we can all learn how to deal with these issues.
And thank you, officer, for doing that, because what I've learned, I'm not an attorney, so I'm not in the courtroom that often. Sometimes I go in and I sit in sessions just to watch the judges, and after a while, sometimes they ask, why am I there? But I do it purposely because they don't know who I am, and it gives me a good sense of what's happening in the various courts. But what I've learned is often it is the guards and the officers and everything who know, because they've trained, they've seen these people before. And they can give you an idea that, there may be something special that we need to deal with. And as I said, it doesn't absolve people's crimes. It just lets you maybe handle the situation differently.
Yes.
So I want to ask you a little bit about this case that you've given to us, the Walden case.
Yes.
This is fascinating. I learned a lot from reading this. I had no idea some of these things. What can you just give us a little synopsis very briefly about this and why you chose this particular case to put in your application?
Well, I chose it because, one, it highlights the important issues that we deal with in the district court.
Sure,
it does. Often, our work in the district court is often minimized as mm-hmm. small matters, inconsequential matters. But we deal with matters of this kind of significance, a possible civil commitment for 6 months, incredible deprivation of personal liberty. And so you want to make sure that the process you use, for getting due process, but also that people are able, people in the field are able to operate in a way that makes sense. So this was a person who I believe that the story started out with. He's sort of running in the street, mm-hmm. a danger to himself because he could be killed by traffic. He's brought into a psychiatric facility for examination within 3 days. If that person doesn't voluntarily want to stay there, and the people believe that EC continues to be at risk, they can petition a court for commitment. And so it comes to our court. We go out to the psychiatric hospital, do my court. Unless they request to come to court with them. And so there's a hearing to determine whether the person should be committed. And the primary witness is the psychiatrist who's been interviewing this person. There is a privilege. There's a privilege between a psychiatrist and a patient. And so the case has to do with the tension between that privilege and that confidentiality. And of course, the need to the emergency nature of the hearing, the need to get that testimony, and ultimately it's an analysis of the different competing statutory provisions. And I authored that decision
we decided, as the appellate division, that the privilege can apply in that particular circumstance. And then it went up to appeal, the appeals court. The Supreme Judicial Court took it on appeal, and it ended up writing a full published opinion, opposed.
And your decision was upheld. Yeah. It's a beautifully written piece. It's also, maybe because I'm not a lawyer, but the whole thing is fascinating. You described it beautifully, the tension between the right to personal liberty and the right to protect somebody. And then, you know, not attorney-client, you know, but doctor-patient privilege. And when, when is it suspended, but when does it take on a different tone? I found it fascinating. I'm going to ask you a question, and it's not a trick question. I don't ask trick questions, but it's something that I'm super concerned about right now. And I don't know if you know anything about it. If you don't, and you go forward, I'd like you to just study it. It's the net neutrality laws that are being suspended.
I heard the term.
Well, we are at a, I would say, a precipice in this country with our right to privacy, with the internet. And again, with the new administration, we have a new Federal Communication Commission. And in fact, we have an Indian American as our new chair, who is a brilliant man, but has very different take on privacy than we as Americans have been used to. And I do believe, I'm convinced these laws, if they are changed, will be challenged in court, and I think they will end up in the appeals courts in the states. And so that's why I say it's very important to learn about it. They've essentially determined, or they are determining, that it is okay to sell anybody's, not just their information, but their search history on anything on the internet to anyone that wants to pay for it. And there is an incredible danger with this. And even as a police officer, there's a danger that this officer could, you know, be researching something on human trafficking or pornography, or child pornography, and who knows how this could be later used against them because it's on the search history. And it could be made public information. It's a very, very, as we say, slippery slope. But it's a very dangerous path that we may be embarking on. So I really hope that you learn about it. We just had someone who I can't think of the name, the engineer, who has a great background in intellectual property. Yeah. Really, I was thrilled with that appointment because we're really going to need people like this. I'm not going to belabor this and keep asking more questions. You've answered a lot already. I know that you know the drug, the opioid crisis is, you know, as we all know, it's an epidemic. I will ask you this though. Have you given any thought, and maybe you haven't had time to, but about, you know, the marijuana is basically going to become legal in the state as soon as they can figure out who gets the tax records. That's why it's about who gets the domain. But, I am hearing from some clinical psychologists who work with addicts that they are very concerned because it's easy to get a prescription, medical marijuana prescription, that they are seeing in their clients, people getting prescriptions, because the pot is a very high quality, it's not tainted with anything, it's pure, seeing it sold on the street, and then that money, they're buying heroin. And it is unexpected consequence, something probably none of us envisioned or thought of. But I also have a strong feeling that we will be hearing many of these, as you said earlier, these sort of intertwined cases in the courts. And I think a lot of them will end up in the appeals court. And they're very, very interesting issues, but they're very complicated issues. And I think the pot thing is all about who gets the money. Everyone wants that piece of marijuana. Tax revenue. I'm finished, Madam Chair. Thank you.
I think I can get the idea of like a woman.
Yeah,
I don't have